And welcome back. RPG Chick back here again. I was lamenting quite a few episodes ago about how I didn't... we couldn't really get back, at least as far as I know, to Sega's Cliffs to, you know, kind of talk to the other NPCs, Matkina and the other guy from the beginning. And I just remember, we have this bronze sphere. We can summon these guys whenever we want. Which is here. So depending on what happens here... hold the orb up to the light again. What happens there? You see, I want to bring Aligern into the party and Matkina and see, you know... obviously, well, I have things to say and people will react to them and stuff. Light sparkles off the razor innards of the sphere. The movement you spotted before is nowhere to be seen. So, Aligern, you feel the sharp edge of his focus directed wholly at the jumble of parts on the workbench before him. Now, we have to let somebody go.
What's on your mind?
So if these people don't come back, then I'm obviously not going to be saving this. I'm going to be... that's the wrong thing.
What's on your mind?
Best we part. Oh, well, if you need a hero, come find me. Where to next? He puts his... Yeah, I'm gonna see what happens. Where to next? He puts his hands on his hips and surveys the area. Still looking around, he says, you probably won't be able to find me again, you know. My adventures will take me everywhere. I've got a way to contact you if I need you. Farewell. His adventure reading around me. Feel it. Okay. So, I purposely... Aligern's probably not going to join the party. Either that or Calistes is going to freak out. Because I'm going to see if I can... oh. That's, what's his name? The button showing a sword made of tiny swords. That's, Aretas. Aligern, I need you to join me. What? Oh, hey, kid. And the answer is no. I could smell Calistes on you. Ask me again when you've dropped her. Okay, let's bring Matkina first, then. What? Matkina says inside your mind. Oh, it's you. Why not?
What do you know? I'm even more deadly.
Ooh, so we got a sonic blade. Can we keep that? Matkina abruptly appears beside you, wobbling on her feet a little. She just gave us this? Or it's equipped? Wait, we gained it because it's hers? So stuff. 4 physical damage, plus 3 damage per effort applied to a max of plus 12. Light weapon bonus, plus 15%. On hit, confers sonic disruption, which is minus 1 armor, active for 1 round. The fine glowing tracery that decorates the length of the blade gives off an eerie purple light. You hear a soft humming coming from it, and you feel it tremble slightly in your grip, as if it is eager to attack. Okay. So this is her stuff. That's weird. I don't remember seeing our gained items from... companions that they already have showing up in here. Matkina's leather armor. 2 armor, 3 resistance. Matkina's leather breastplate appears roughly made, but it is of good quality. It is light and flexible, but offers her some measure of protection. Her cloak. Plus 10% willpower. Matkina's cloak is a simple cloth garment, ordinary, but for several weightless canisters attached to it. These devices appear to absorb energies. Okay, so let's talk to her. Well, let's check out her stuff first.
You need me?
Learned nano who breathes shadow. Wait, that's me. Furtive Jack who murders. Matkina is the kind of ally you want at your side rather than watching your back. This tells us about Jax, which you know about. Matkina is the deadliest assassin in the Protectorate and known as such, sort of focus of murders. So she has these abilities. She's trained without armor. Who needs armor? It's slow and cumbersome, and that extra weight might just get you killed. You prefer speed and mobility anyway. I gotta look at all the, what's armoratic wound? When Matkina is hidden or the target is blinded, gain plus 20% on attacks and confer or extend blinded on the target. Matkina prefers to stalk the battlefield unseen. So long as she's undetected, her attacks inflict deeper wounds on her enemies and blind them with the tidal energy swirling about her. Cast off vitality. Warp dash. Ooh, that seems neat. Teleport to a point and attack all enemies within short range of the point. Enemies that fail to resist take one transdimensional damage and are hobbled. A place exists under space, a way to connect two points by folding the fabric of reality. By touching these points together, you can almost be in two places at once, and the resulting burst of energy slows your foes. Very cool. Trained infiltrator. All other party members gain plus 5% on deception and stealth tasks. The cast-off's quiet, calculated presence inspires her allies to greater heights of deception and stealth. Pretty cool character for combat, huh? I can't really get rid of the others, though. I really don't want to. Really, if I had one extra slot, she would definitely go there. Codex, journal, which is just everything. So alright, these are our items. And that's her. Swish, swish, swish. It's a plastic cloak. Cheap and plastic. Alright, let's talk to her.
Traveling with you is like being part of a circus. Everyone stares.
All the better to hide yourself in my shadow, dear. For who will look at you when I am around?
Exactly the kind of people I'm trying to avoid.
Well, you're not going to hang out with her that long.
We're not safe yet. Not by a long shot. I don't remember if I told you this, but I was born here.
Interesting. She struggles to hide the fear that shivers through her frame. You can feel the tight control she maintains over her emotions, over her tides. She swallows hard. Woke up in the process of being devoured. I suppose the bloom saw our sire's mind leave. It dropped me, newborn, and I got out. Fled up the Sagus cliffs, and that thrice damned sorrow almost snatched me then. Her voice drops, almost indistinct. I left the city, stole and hurt people on the way out, but at least I got away. So, you know what happened with the cast-offs. With the first, damn her, and let's be sure to kill her when we find her. Anyway, the bloom. After the trouble with Melmoth, I wound up here, in the service of the man who became the Memorera, the old boss of this place. Listen to me. The bloom rewards cruelty and pain, and it will react to your actions, so be careful. The current Memorera and I don't get along too well. Be aware there's a history, a bloody one. I can't promise I'll be civil around her. She adjusts her cloak. All right, let's go. You're not going to be here that much longer. You said you and the Memorera had a history. So what's interesting is that we're looking at this now, but since we're already here, we're probably getting more information out of her than if she had joined the party, you know, back in Sagus Glyphs. She and I were Chagans, for the old Memorera. Ran different games, different tents. Or turts, rather. But it was always a competition with her. See who could make more shins, who could keep the peace better, who could embarrass the other. I always got the sense she had a secret. Something she was keeping from the rest of us. But I never had any proof. She shrugs. Not until the day she took power. She was quick, I'll give her that. Not a moment wasted. I thought she'd let the rest of us run. She didn't. When she sent bounty hunters after me, I knew the game had changed. Used to be the Chagans that get a choice, swear fealty or leave, because, you know, blood is bad for business. Better to keep all our knowledge alive, right? I'd have sworn, because I admired her efficiency, but she didn't give me the choice. Nor any of them. She's ruthless and vindictive. Be careful around her. This is good information, actually. Let's talk about you. She gives you a slow, evaluating look. You are a part of my story. What else do you need to know? How did you become an assassin, anyway? A series of regrettable mistakes. Maybe I'll tell you about them someday, but not now. How did Ning lose his eyes? He got himself crosswise with the wrong people, and he had an accident. She thinks an unforgivable accident. An unavoidable accident. Accident. Why keep saying accent? Did you ever see Paj Reckon again? Once, in Milavest, Paj didn't even remember Colne Village. She didn't remember the people she'd sacrificed for her pointless, endless war. And she couldn't even understand why I'd care. I'd have had her throat if her dearest hadn't held me back, upheld her precious peace. And then when Paj was gone and I'd calmed down, one of the others asked me what the problem was. He said the villagers would all have been dead in a few decades anyway. I vowed I'd never think like that. But here I am, a couple centuries later, and people seem to die too fast and too young, and I can't let myself care. She scuffs the dirt. Immortality is a curse, especially when your companions are in eternity or cast-offs. She thinks maybe it would be better if the sorrow had us all. She cursed me with a perspective I didn't want, and I hate her for it. I wanted to talk about what happened to you after I left Tasha's body in the mirror. I don't know when you left. Tash wiped my memories and... Wait. No. No, he went off with the first militia. I came back to find him, and we had words. I left his burnt corpse in a shallowed grave, and then... She shrugs eloquently. I assume the scavengers took it. After that, I traveled the world. I went back to Colne to remind myself what humanity does to the strange and different. I realized I had no purpose. I went to Milavest to see what our brethren were doing. They hadn't changed at all. They told me to gather power. She barks a laugh. Our Creator made us many things, but most of all, He made us mad for strength in all its forms. I scorned their advice, but the more I thought about it, the more I realized the truth. When you're powerful, people can't hurt you. Her voice drops. Or the ones you love. I'm gonna let her continue. So I came to Sega's Cliffs. I started working. One of our brothers hired me, and then he betrayed me. I thought he helped me, but just like Paj, just like the first, just like Tash, he turned on me. That's when I learned that I can't trust anyone. So I struck back at him. Hard. It was then that I decided to make my own organization. That lasted for about a decade. The endless politics inside the group, the recriminations, fighting amongst other gangs, the inevitable betrayals, ugh. I gave up on that and went solo. Eventually I went back to the Bloom and worked for the Memovira. The old one, I mean. Those were good years. I felt like I belonged. There was friction, to be sure, but we were a team. And then my favorite mortal got betrayed, too. She crosses her arms. You want to know why I was hiding before you found me? It's because I learned that I'm best on my own. If you don't have people, you can't be betrayed. There. You've got your story. Let's not talk about that anymore. She shifts slightly, hands on her belt. Let's talk about our siblings. Here it comes. She acts as if she's readying herself for a storm. I'm ready for the litany. All you newborns have it. All right. Go. Let's talk about the changing god. He's a greedy, manipulative, domineering fool. I've also heard he's quite charming, witty, and an absolute genius. I suppose he'd have to be, given how long he's managed to keep ahead of the Sorrow. But I've never met him, as far as I know, so the only judgment I have on the man is what I've heard from others. I mean, our father inspired a cult. I assume you've met Kazmin and Mimian? Ugh. What's missing from their lives is that they'd have to pin their hopes on us. I don't remember too much about them. About our conversation with them, that was way back. Maybe they recognize our potential and hope to replicate it in themselves. Ooh, gold tide, small amount. We make such fine examples, she scoffs, but she looks thoughtful. You know more than the rest of us. All I know is that he's not to be trusted, not in any of his guises. Agreed there. How have you avoided the Sorrow? What can you tell me about it? I know a little more than you. They might know more in Vila Vest. What I can tell you for sure is that it hates us castoffs. You're never sure when it'll come. Well, it's I don't think anyone knows anything anymore in Vila Vest. She shivers slightly. It comes for each of us, like we're calling to it. As for how I avoid the Sorrow, well, you've got the feeling that someone's looking at you? The Sorrow's attention is like that, except it feels like you've made an enemy. The creeping paranoia that's coming for you. Slow urgency mounts, and then you start to feel like you need to lash out. But what I do, I run. I leave, and I don't come back. Try to throw off whatever scent it's picked up. And after a while, the pressure eases, and I can come back again. I don't try to go somewhere safe, like Vila Vest. It'll find me eventually. It always finds us. The best we can do is postpone the inevitable. Her eyes are haunted. What I know is that we have to stop it. Stop it for good. How are you holding up? She shrugs. Do you actually care? Not that much. I had some questions about the people we're traveling with. Oh, gossip. She raises an eyebrow. How exciting. Any thoughts about Calistige? She hides her secrets. She's welcome to them, as long as she's not spilling mine. Calistige says, I could hardly be less interested in your tawdry little mysteries. You? Maybe not, but I've seen the way some of your sisters stare at me. Don't mind them, dear. Some of us have the most malevolent eyes. So, tell me about Tybir. I'm not saying I don't trust him, but... Actually, I am saying that I don't trust him. Wise advice, Tybir says. I haven't trusted myself in years. I'm surprised you even know what wisdom looks like. Or trust. Nice. She's really pleasant, isn't she? Great. What do you think, Calistine? What do you think about Matkina? There's nothing more tiresome than an indecisive assassin who refuses to seize control of her future. Ruthlessness is a job requirement, not a choice. Matkina says, I'm thinking of seizing something right now. Are you, dear? Good for you. Too funny.
Stop thinking about your Vila Vest. You know, you build up an impression of what a city of immortals might look like. Libraries and such. Maybe some tea shops. That wasn't a city. That was a prison built by your changing god. And your siblings live there by choice, bickering over who owns the cutlery while their executioner waits at the door. Why do all of you let him get away with it?
And he thinks, what was I thinking following her? I really haven't talked to him for that long. I mean, Vila Vest is gone now. You're being unfair to the cast-offs. Everyone works with the life they're given. Indigo. That's the problem right there, he declares, smacking his palm with his fist. You're damn near immortal. You don't make do with a bad hand, sorrow or no. You grab hold. You change things. You make a name for yourself. He trails off, hearing his own words. Oh, he says with a sad smile. Listen to me. I doubt your changing God would have phrased things much different, would he? I never set out to hurt anyone, he says, planting his hands on his hips, as though he is holding himself in place. But I did. Didn't always mean to, but there it is. His hands tighten on his hips, shackles of flesh and tendon. I regret every time I left a friend to take the bite for me. I do, and I swear I'll never run again. But then I do it again. He closes his eyes. Do what again? Oh, he says miserably, rubbing his eyes. If only I could tally my mistakes as easily as that. But I've made a lot of them, and I wouldn't know where to start. He grimaces. Put it like this. I'm alive, and happy I am. But Riss was far from the first friend I left behind. His teeth graze his lips, and he hastily adds, accident or no. You're being too hard on yourself. Kind of you to say, he says, though he doesn't sound like he means it. I wish you were right. He straightens with visible effort, favoring you with a smile. But let me bear my own conscience. What do you need? Have I asked this? Where do you think Orvin is now? He's still in that little Nylash. I think I asked all this. Yeah, he probably said that already. For all I know. It's a lower intestine the size of a city, and I don't miss the time I lived here. Talking about all the speech there. I don't recall, but I don't know. He relents with a smile. Fine, ask away. This is all again. Oh. Parson Flint? He's a smiling parasite, Tiber says cheerfully. He deals in despair and has a lot of loyal customers. Can't stand the man. Tell me about Briska. Briska's alright, for a paid neckbreaker. You know where you are with her, at least. Does her job, cares for her people, keeps her word. He snorts. That's more than I can say for a lot of the honest commanders I've known. She's a thug, but a trustworthy one. Take that for what it's worth.
Yes, lass.
What? I can ask him about I don't have Charming little thing, I think, and beautiful in his own way. Why can I ask him about Bug. Matkina. Dangerous one, isn't she? All blades and edges. I try not to have opinions about people who slit throats for a living. Relax, Matkina says. No one's paid me to kill you. Not yet, anyway. Ah, that's a comfort, he says, rolling his eyes. So funny. Okay. So, what I want to do now... Calistee's size.
Well then, farewell. For now. You won't be gone long.
She takes in her surroundings. You realize you won't be able to find me again, don't you? I won't be staying here, that's for certain. Should you come to your senses? Well... Alright, so... Let's... Bring back... So that's her. Touch the button with the circle of interlocking hand mirrors engraved upon it. Alright, made of a button showing a sword made of tiny swords. You poke the button and hear an Eretus's voice within your mind. I wonder what would happen if I dueled myself. Is this actually you? Eretus shouts in your mind. Yes, 100 dozen times, yes.
Strange.
With a soft pop,
is occurring to me.
Eretus appears beside you. Okay, so now I get to ask them.
Ask your questions.
About themselves. Eretus, I've killed people for lesser offenses than he offers moment to moment. No back and forth there, huh?
What's on your mind?
Huh. Other people are traveling with us? He says, shocked. He spins around suspiciously and spots Matkina for what is apparently the first time. His jaw drops. He is spotting her for the first time. So he thinks, a love interest, she will reject him. He will strive to impress her. We wish to see this. Matkina says, what? Why are you looking at me like that? Eretus takes a breath and tries again. He explains, with the expression of a drowning man. His golden aura pulses, possibly in time with his heartbeat. Well then, his heart is beating very fast, very quickly indeed. She stares at him, unblinking, and turns to you. Why is he looking at me like that? You two are going to make such a great couple. Her eyes go wide in horror. Then she glares at Eretus. Don't. Really, don't. In so much as I have a type, you aren't it. Eretus takes a shuddering gasp, blinks with what appears to be every muscle in his body, and rips his gaze from Matkina. What? What were we talking about? Oh, the others. Who do you want my opinion on? Matkina. She's kind, smart, and beautiful, he says, blushing a little. Also, I hate to admit this, but I think she might be a better fighter than I am. Don't tell her I said any of that, all right? I am literally standing right here, she turns to you. Is he messing with me? Ah, he says, flinching away from her. Did I mention she's stealthy? She's the stealthiest woman I've ever fallen in love with. Met? What does that mean? I've ever met instead of fallen in love with. Does this just repeat? Don't tell her I said that. That is too funny. That's exactly why I do stuff like this. Okay, let's...
What's on your mind?
Let's do that again. Now let's bring in Aligern. Aligern, I need you to join me. Huh? Aligern says in your mind. Oh, it's you. Sure, kid.
Ready to test this out.
Aligern abruptly appears beside you, wobbling on his feet a little. Alright. First time we've spoken to him since, like, I don't know, episode 8 or something. He purses his lips but says nothing. I forgot to look at his stuff. This time we didn't have the stuff added, like what happened with Matkina. Yeah, that was weird. Hardened Nano who fights with his demons. Aligern has had a tough life. It's given him a unique outlook on problem solving. Focus fights with his demons. Aligern's tattoos seem to be a source of great pain for him, but they're also a source of great power. Tattoos, like in Planescape Torment. Okay, so he's got Aligern's vest. This vest belongs to Aligern. It doesn't offer much protection to his arms, but it is made of a material tough and thick enough to absorb glancing blows. One armor, two resistance. For all I know, I looked at this stuff already, but it's been so long. His coat has plus 15% willpower. Aligern's dusty leather coat has seen long years of use. Pockets line its surface, and a latticework of wires covers over a strange star on the jacket's breast. And he's got a mace, and we've seen what a mace is all about. Aligern likes the last cast off. Put him out. Matkina is neutral toward the last cast off. So he's no longer thinking I'm the changing god, I guess? Oh wait, I forgot to look at his, wrong thing. His abilities, character sheet. So he has living tattoos. While active, use similar actions, attacks, defensive esoteric ciphers, or healing esoteric or ciphers, multiple turns in a row to chain increasing effects. Using a different kind of action breaks the chain and removes the fettle. When the chain reaches 4, the fettle is removed. Active entire crisis, no action required. Aligern's tattoos swarm and swirl over his skin, lending themselves to whatever purpose the former priest puts his mind to, each building on the similar strength of the last. So he's also got Innervate, which we've seen that. Concentration increase, +1 training skill. Cipher limit increase. And resourceful. +1 training and cipher use skill. So that's why he can have so many ciphers. Can he have all these ciphers? No, I think just he can have 5 ciphers, I believe. Alright, let's talk to the guy. If he has any further insight. How are you holding up? As well as can be expected. Let's talk about you and your story. Not exactly my favorite topic. Fine. Ask. Can you tell me about your history? He watches silently for a moment, considering his words. I am not from around here. I was a local Aeon priest for a small aldea. Ormin, it was called. Far west of here. Things happened. I left. Here I am. He thinks nowhere to go back to. You said things happened that made you leave your village. What things? He shakes his head slowly. I'm not ready to talk about it yet. You said you were an Aeon priest. What's the story with that? I worked with them for years, but when I came to them for help, they refused me. They gave me no time, no resources, and no aid. They said I had to give up my researches. Said I was... He bites off the last word. Obsessed. He's thinking, obsessed, they said. Heartless bastards. How can I not be? He grunts and looks away. The Order of Truth and I don't get on. They think I'm carked, and I think they're frauds. We exchange these little pleasantries every time we meet. Only got one friend left there, and I can't even contact him most of the time. You already know I hate them. What more should I say? They turn their backs on me when I need it the most. They're lazy, craven, and turn away from the truth if it scares them. They care far less about knowledge than holding on to their positions. Why do the Aeon priests think you're carked? Because I speak my mind to them. Who's your friend at the Order of Truth? Orth Fong. He does a little research for me from time to time. Personal work. I don't remember him. Can you tell me about your tattoos? They look almost alive. He looks at you, finger tapping his lips, and then says, poison from the monsters that ate my family. Scars to remind me of my failures. Battle scars, and a reminder of my failures as an Aeon priest. How did you come to travel with Calistes? When the Order of Truth failed me, I sought other help. Calistes was known for finding things, so despite her reputation for being unreliable, I approached her, and she accepted, provided I help her find a way to achieve her transcendence. His eyes go far away for a moment. She seemed so kind at first, but when it became clear neither of us could help the other, she became cruel and spiteful. I don't know why I stayed after that, or why she stayed with me. Habit, I suppose. I hired her to help me find my family and then couldn't get rid myself of her. He shakes his head. Why she wanted to stay with me, I don't know. Did you and Calistes have a relationship? He grunts. If you can call clawing and scratching at each other a relationship, then I suppose. His eyes grow far away. It was pleasant at the beginning. I needed solace, and she needed validation, perhaps. But when I failed her, she grew bitter and cutting, and I never heard the end of it. She used her words like a whip, and she cut me down to the bone. Okay, so that's it. What do you think of Tiber? Right, he never met Tiber. A liar and a know-nothing. At least he doesn't expect you to hold up your side of a conversation. So yeah, he split. We parted ways before he brought anyone else into the party. I had to choose at one point between Callistes and Aligern. As you say, I still have to choose. And, yeah, that's it. We found Tiber next. Tiber says, "Very true. I can entertain myself and countless others for hours." Good. Why don't you go looking for them? What do you think of Matkina? I don't think about her. You poke predators, they tend to poke back. I'll keep my distance, thanks. Matkina says, "I appreciate that. You smell like an old coat that's been left out in the rain." Well, these people don't like each other very much. Didn't we find you living in a cave? I wouldn't start down the path of who smells worse if I were you. Wow. I think if we had him in the party, one or both of these people might want to leave eventually, which would be interesting. Okay. So, I think all I do now is tell him to leave. There's nothing much new from him. And here I thought we were getting along so splendidly. The irony in his voice is betrayed by the hurt in his eyes. I'll be staying here, that's for certain. I don't imagine we'll be crossing paths again anytime soon. So long. Someone snorted. Okay, so we'll bring... Wait. There's like stuff floating in there. I didn't get to ask... Alright, let's bring him back. I didn't get to have Aligern talk about Aretas and etc.
Ready to test this out.
Okay. So now we have Matkina leave.
Ask your questions.
I don't think that's a good idea. We work well together, but fine. She takes in her surroundings, but I'm not sticking around here. You had a hard time finding me the first time, you know. You might not be able to do it again. I've got things to figure out anyway. See you around. Maybe. Alright, so Aretas. So I can have him interact with Aligern. I just want to see what she says. You press the button with your thumb and instantly feel eyes, countless eyes, outnumbering the stars, turn towards you, seeking your identity and your secrets. Callistes. Callistes and her sisters. You're still with him, aren't you? I told you how I felt about that. If he leaves, you may ask me again. Otherwise... Aretas?
idea is occurring to me.
Okay, Aligern. What do you think about Aretas? He's certainly animated and more than a little exhausting. Aretas says, "Have no fear. If you collapse on the ground, I will carry you gently onwards, like the frailest of blushing maidens." Well, there's another image I'll never get out of my head.
What's on your mind?
And what do you think about Aligern? He's really smart, Aretas says, tickling his fingers, and interesting. Funny, too. He hesitates. I don't understand a lot of what he says, though. Aligern says, that might be because most insults go right over your head. Might be, Aretas says cheerfully. Oh, all right. All right, Aligern, we're done. Says Callous Jesus' voice inside your head. Oh, it's you, dear. Of course. I'll be right there.
This should be useful. My thanks.
Okay, we got the group together again. So, thanks so much for watching. See you next time, guys, when we actually go into the vast interior. Endure and enduring. Grow strong.